Welcome back to our Proactive London studio. I'm joined here now by Hector McNeil, who is the co-founder and co-CEO of HANetf, Europe's preeminent provider of white label ETFs. Hector, a very warm welcome to you once again.
Thank
and
you.
We're going to be talking now about Sharia press releases. What's all this about?
Yeah, so we've always had a bit of a history around areas of expertise around things like ESG, Sharia, etc. We had some expertise with an active global equity fund that was issued on behalf of the US largest manager of Sharia money. And also just recently, which is what you're referring to, the Royal Mint Physical Gold ETC, the responsibly sourced one, just got its Sharia fatwa stamped, you know, by Sharia advisors. And essentially it makes it benign for Islamic investors from that perspective.
Understood. So what is it that was potentially unbenign or malign, I suppose, about press releases that haven't been through this process?
So what you've got where you've got products that go through the Sharia process, there's obviously like a checklist of items. I mean, I always believe that Sharia was like the first real definable ESG in the markets, because essentially it's all about, you know, the various, what you would expect in the ESG world, harmful weapons or items, you know, and obviously there's some structural aspects around interest, etc., which the Sharia laws dictate on. So what happens is they have what they call scholars, who are essentially Islamic auditors, and they ask for submission around the process and the products, prospectuses, you know, detail around it. They'll ask a bunch of questions, and then after a period of time, they'll say whether it meets those standards or it doesn't meet those standards. And because the Royal Mint Physical Gold, you know, from a different number of angles, it's pretty straightforward. It only holds gold, so there's no interest element to that, you know. And obviously gold, all it does is do what it does in the tin. It's a lump of metal, so that goes up and down in value, and obviously the ETFs track that. But also there's some nice green elements to the Royal Mint Physical Gold, in fact, including the name is responsible sourcing, because we only use the highest standard of responsibly sourced LMMA bars. And most recently, I think we're up to about a quarter of the 850 million in there now is backed by recycled bars as well. And recycled gold is 95% less carbon intensive than mine gold. So obviously when you mine gold, there's a huge amount of carbon footprint in that, logistics, toxicity, all that sort of stuff. But if you recycle it, it becomes part of that circular economy. So that whole gambit of the ESG green element of it and the Sharia element, you know, makes it, you know, very benign from both a Sharia investor and an ESG investor.
It sounds like there could actually be some overlap in those cases where knowing that the investment was Sharia friendly happened to also mean that it was ESG friendly as well.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, with our global equity fund from Saturna, the ticker is AML, you tend to find that ESG investors will look at that and probably, you know, go past the first hurdle because it has got that Sharia stamp on it, the fatwa. So they'll know that the screens that are involved in that will be very similar to the ESG screens, maybe even further down the road on that. So, you know, so there's a lot of commonality in how you approach, you know, Sharia investments versus ESG. So it's quite an interesting world. And, you know, obviously what that does as well is it gives a broader collective of products that's available for Islamic investors, because ultimately it makes it very easy for them to then do their due diligence and say, you know, what they do, because the fatwa is an actual document they can read through and see the analysis. And, it, you know, there's no sort of SFDR standards or EU standards or FCA standards like there is, in that world. With the Islamic world, it really just comes down to a bunch of scholars who you work with and you pay. So some people will say they accept those types of scholars versus other ones, or they may do more analysis. But essentially, it's a guiding set of principles which everybody buys into.
Understood. And so, do you consider this is going to help open up the Gulf markets for you?
Yeah, I think across the board. Actually, I think there'll be. Interestingly enough, there's a platform called Wahid Invest. I don't know if you know that platform, but it's quite similar to Nutmeg in the UK. But it's focused very much on Islamic investors, and they'd already done their own fatwa on the Royal Mint Physical Gold ETF, and they'd approved it for their platform, so they were already using it as their go-to gold product. In fact, they announced recently they're going to back a credit card using gold, which is the proxy is going to be the Royal Mint Physical Gold product. So we already knew that Islamic investors liked the product, but essentially if we had our own fatwa, you know, people could rely on that outside that, and someone like Wahid probably can afford to do that, whereas other people would need to rely on someone else. So that's why we thought it was important to have that stamp of approval.
So are there any other candidates among your portfolio of ETFs you think might be in line for same thing?
I don't think there's anything we've got there that we're going to do in terms of fatwa for, but we are looking at doing more Sharia new products. So we get a lot of, in fact, we had a call yesterday from a Saudi client who was looking to enter the ETF market using our services. And we probably get those, you know, I'd say one in 30 calls, you know, will be related to that, you know, whether it's Sukuk bonds or, you know, equities or whatever investments it is, you know. So there's definitely interest in that. And, you know, whether it's, you know, you can sell these into Indonesia and Malaysia or the Gulf or even the US as well. I mean, it's a Turner, our partner in, who's in Washington State on the west coast of the US. I think they manage about $8 billion of assets, which is related to Sharia money. So it's a real investment. You know, it's a real sector.
There's something for everyone in this world of ETFs, isn't there?
There is, yeah. I mean, the funniest one I saw recently was in the US. A firm brought out a Democrats ETF and a Republicans ETF. And they're supposed to be the baskets, the holdings are supposed to be skewed towards the left and the right. So yeah, you've got Catholic values ETFs in globally. I think I've mentioned to you before, we've got a space ETF that the ticker's Yoda, you know, so space technology and what's going on in that sector. So yeah, you really get, and it's going more that way. I mean, there's even a lady talking to us in the US who maybe wants to bring a product to Europe, and she calls it the democracy ETF, and it only invests in companies that are in countries that, you know, are seen as democratic countries. And her belief is there's a higher valuation to those stocks than if they are in a non-democratic country. And she's quite an interesting character. She used to fly helicopters in the US Marines. So it really, and what's nice about all these for me is they all have nice stories. So when you talk to the sponsor behind it or the owner, you know, they're just fascinating to hear for the next 20 minutes how they got to where they got to and how they formed their view. And then they can then as a asset manager, they can then use their knowledge and experience and then create a product out of it they can offer to other people.
Yeah, but the HANetf Christmas party is good fun.
Certainly is. And it gets better every year. That's for sure.
All right. Well, you'll have to send me an invite, Hector. But until then, thank you very much for coming to talk to us at Proactive.
No problem. Thank you.